All right, then. This is a podcast attempt, contractual obligation to our donors, our very generous donors, who are fantastic and amazing people. And purely as well to their enjoyment and their enlightenment, here we have Nathaniel Hayward, who is an extremist, who is going to give us a good view about things.
Hello. We have guns to our heads. Please send help.
So what do you think about the whole Trump thing, banning CNN and the New York Times and just about a whole other host of liberal media from the press conferences that came out just today?
I mean, I can see why you'd do it, but I definitely wouldn't do it.
Well, why is that?
Well, because it might legitimize their criticism.
I think it was a fantastic thing to do.
Why is that?
Because these people, I mean, we have to be honest here and acknowledge that these people have, first of all, they have delegitimized him constantly, saying that the election result was not valid because Russia somehow tampered with the results, again relying on rumors from the CIA, which I mean, there is some degree that you could say is not only unprofessional but kind of treasonous as well. I mean, to what extent can you cooperate with that?
Well, you can still cooperate with it in the sense that you have no real option. You want to maintain a legitimate democracy because it doesn't matter how dirty your opponents get with words, you still have to include them in the discussion because it lends your presidency, in this case, legitimacy. And it means, you know, if you're a mature person, a mature organization, you can deal with this level of pathetic criticism. I mean, you can literally just point out where there's factual errors, etc., etc. They don't seem to be doing that very well, or they haven't. Well, in the past couple. Sean Spicer seems a little bit out of his depth at times. Other times he's very good.
He was very good at clearing up the fact that Donald Trump does not own a bathrobe. Do you remember that one?
I do not,
no. Oh, no, there was this thing about he was walking around in his bathrobe or something, apparently. And somebody reported that, and he came out and said, no, that's not possible because Donald Trump does not own a bathrobe. And I mean, for one, I think that's the kind of, you know, clarification that we need from an administration, I think.
Well, I think that portrays a certain level of, a disturbing level of intimacy there. And I for one, cannot buy the fact that Donald Trump doesn't have a silk dressing gown with his initials emblazoned on the breast. I mean, that's just not possible.
No, I think everybody knows that he just walks around naked, so...
Why not Churchill did that?
Well, there we go. There's even precedent for it. You can't
precedent for it in the sense that he did it on the presidential yacht.
Well, you can't get more statesmanlike than that, I think. I can only wonder what I don't know, the goal did or some other person like that. Actually, I don't want to wonder. But anyway, I mean, I think like it is a bit extreme, I suppose, just in comparison to anything that came before, and it is true, I suppose, because I've seen the Guardian come out and say, I mean, they've been saying this for a while, saying, oh, you know, the Trump wants to shut the media down, and that's the act of a dictator. I mean, could be.
Yeah, I mean, this is my issue, is that even if they're wrong, it lends credence to what they're saying, when there should be no credence to what they're saying, because they are doling out fake news constantly, you know, in the comments about Sweden, just for one example.
What happened to that? Well,
so the interesting thing there was, he said, like last night in Sweden. Now, what he was saying was not technically, he didn't say this terrorist attack in Sweden. He could have just simply been saying, which is what I think he was saying, there's things happening every night in Sweden. So I can basically say, last night in Sweden something happened. I mean, you can't say that, because that happens all the time. So, for instance, obviously there was the riots, which happened the day before yesterday, wasn't it? Burning, you know, they burned a whole load of shit.
I haven't actually seen it. Yeah. I mean, maybe I've been out of the loop.
The riots in Stockholm.
I mean, I remember, like, I know, as a matter of fact, that there is some bad hombres in Sweden. Just by the sheer fact that I remember, actually, I was working at the Wetherspoons overnight, and we came out for the break one night, and on the news there was a BBC It was on BBC News, you know, there's a whole, like, special report on extremist mosques in Sweden that nobody could get into. And the police were like, yeah, you know, there's extremists, there's ISIS recruiters in Sweden, in these mosques, you know. So it is evidently a problem, like, I won't deny that. I mean, there's some truth to that, but if you ask me on the details, I wouldn't know.
Well, no, the issue is that, A, the press in Sweden essentially locks this stuff down. I mean, one of their chief police officers kind of broke ranks and admitted there's a huge problem with ethnic-related crime in Sweden. Massive amount of rape there. It's now one of the rape capitals of the world, if you look at the statistics. Also, there's obviously the issue with the fact that this is simply being covered up. So, for instance, you're no longer allowed to report on the ethnic characteristics of the perpetrators of the crime.
Why have they done that? How do they find them?
Well, exactly. They don't, right? So anyway, this whole issue proves that the press is very ready to accuse Donald Trump of making stuff up when he's not, you know. So they accuse him of lying when he's not. So they said, oh, nothing, you know, Sweden's fine. What are they talking about? You know? And who's the YouTube commenter? Is it Paul Joseph Watson or whatever his name is?
Oh, Paul Joseph Watson. It's a bit of a weird one. I have mixed feelings about him.
Well, that's by the by. Invited, you know, he said, I will pay for any journalist to go and live in suburbs of Malmo or Stockholm in Sweden. And, you know, he was kind of laughed out of town kind of thing on Twitter. And then the day after, the evening after, this massive riot erupts in Stockholm. You know, they have had, before they had massive riots, they have constant issues. All kinds of things going wrong there.
But who are these people? Are they the refugees or are they run-of-the-mill immigrants? As in, like,
a mixture of both. As you and I both know, a lot of these refugees in there are not strictly speaking refugees.
I think that is profoundly racist, but go on.
I'm not sure that that is racist in any sense of that word. But so I mean, obviously, a lot of these people are coming from countries which are not necessarily complete war zones. There are issues in those countries, just as there are all around the world. Also, there's the fact that they're going all the way to Sweden, right in the northern hemisphere, when they've got plenty of countries around them which they can have safe harbour in, under UN regulations, by the way.
Actually, I think that's a very good point, because I saw, this is unbelievable. I saw this thing on BBC Three, I think it was. It was like, it was something silly, like questions that refugees are tired of hearing, or something like that. And then...
BBC?
BBC Three.
Oh, it's all BuzzFeed, isn't it? Yeah.
Well, it's basically BuzzFeed now. And then one of the questions was, why didn't you stay in the first safe country that you arrived in? And then, did you move countries, you know, like, when you got here? And one guy, who was like a doctor or something, he wasn't some idiot or some peasant. He was a fully qualified doctor. And he was saying, like, oh, yeah, I got on a truck from Greece to through Italy, and arrived here in Britain, and somebody had commented on the link on the Facebook saying, wow, I was thinking of going to Italy for holidays, but I didn't know it was that bad.
It's what I like to call the Goldilocks approach to claiming a refuge, really. Actually, you know, it's ridiculous. It's like, you know, for instance, this Tory MP, I forget her name, has been howled down in France, daring to suggest that France isn't actually Nazi Germany. That these children who are, you know, apparently have to be brought over, or people in general, refugees in general, are in, you know, massive danger. I'm sorry, what?
Well, I mean, I don't think the danger thing is believable. Although I do have a very practical, a very pragmatic kind of idea of why they would move. Which is the simple case that they probably have a better grasp of English than they would have of Italian or French or anything like that.
For our listeners, I definitely don't live with my parents still.
Neither do I. I live in a Trump Tower.
I live in my mum's basement. I've got some AKs in the back of the room.
There we go. We have a homegrown terrorist right here.
Exactly. Someone come and radicalize me, please. Can it be Stephen Bannon?
I think the Catholic Church has already done that. Cardinal Vincent Nichols. I think it's just a very pragmatic kind of interpretation. Is that it's just the fact that they speak English already, and they don't speak French, or they don't speak Italian, or Greek, which no one speaks. I don't, you know, probably even the Greeks have a hard time with it. So it makes sense, I suppose, in that regard.
I've known a few Greeks; they've never really struggled to talk. Believe me, they like a good argument.
I mean, wouldn't you say?
Certainly, that's a pragmatic way of looking at it. That's definitely one of their reasons for trying to head to places like the UK and Sweden and Denmark. Obviously, there is also the case that those countries do happen to have a reputation for having most generous welfare states.
Speaking as somebody who is on welfare at the moment, I would call it many things, but I wouldn't call it generous.
Well, you're in a certain situation. That is, a young single male looking for work. You're on job seekers allowance or whatever.
Job seekers.
That's a slightly different situation to a young family or young people of, say, North African descent. Or wherever they're coming from, who are going to pump out a load of kids. You know. That's easy breadwinnings right there. Plus, you can claim all kinds of different benefits. You know, winter fuel, blah, 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 you know, all kinds of things.
See,
supplementary this, supplementary that. So you can make a fair living out of these things. We know that. There's numerous cases of it. It's getting a lot harder. But the reputation is still there.
I think it would be dangerous. I suppose there is a case for like limiting, you know, people who just arrived fresh off the boat in dubious circumstances. What kind of benefits and how many benefits they can possibly claim, just on the sheer basis that, say, in my case, I am a taxpayer, and I have paid a lot of tax. Believe me, you know, when I was working. The amount of tax that was deducted off my wages was unbelievable. And like, I'd say now that I'm claiming job seekers allowance, over time it's pretty much the stuff I put in anyway.
Yeah.
Whereas, I suppose, if you come in and you have not contributed tax-wise whatsoever, and it seems as if you aren't going to be contributing anytime soon, you know, that's a bad case, maybe.
Well, new figures released, I believe, today, or at least sifted today, show that 65% of immigrants come to a job. Okay, that's a good way of spinning it. Another way of spinning it is 35% come and they do not have a job. They do not find a job within the first year. There is also the case, obviously, that in Islamic communities, large proportions of the women never work and will never work.
Well, I mean, I wouldn't. That's not something I would condemn, though. Because, I mean, this will have to be taken down, but I'm not a great proponent of women working.
Neither am I.
I'm not that guy who's going to go, yeah, let's get all the mothers out there working.
Yeah, neither am I, but I'm not necessarily dealing with this ideologically in that sense. I'm dealing with it in a statistical sense, in a pure resource-related sense, okay? So these are the same women who will have a lot of children. There will be new generation immigrants. Their ancestors will not have contributed to the making of these fine institutions that we have in this country. I can't say that without a laugh.
Nothing beats the Department of Working Pensions.
No, exactly.
It is the hallmark of civilization, I think.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's the thing, isn't it? But all kidding aside, that is definitely a case. To be made, in as much as any community has to have a right over who is a member of that community.
No, I do think that is a legitimate point, which I think for some reason people seem to struggle with. I mean, it's the same thing with Trump. The same thing with Trump deporting illegals. I mean, surely the fact that America is an independent nation state, they can decide that, you know, they don't want people who have broken laws to come in and stay. And people are like, well, but these people have a right. And it's like, well, they don't, actually. There is no right to live in a particular place. There's no such thing anywhere. I mean, it's a nice thing. It's a nice thing to be able to live in a different place, but it's not a right.
No, but I mean, that's a hallmark of kind of modern left-wing people, is that they do generally assume that their wants are rights. Basically, because they inhabit the world of a 12-year-old, or you know, at least least an early teenager. That's generally the conceptual world in which they inhabit. And we're seeing that with the transgender movement to a great degree. You must show me respect. You must use one of my 31 pronouns. That's not how that works.
It's a transgender bathroom.
Well, I think actually we have to take a step back from that particular issue just because some of the fine ecclesiasts from our own church do tend to support that particular arrangement. I could quote you a particular Jesuit father. I think it's Father James Martin, S.J.
Have not heard
of him.
Oh.
He's the president. You should have heard of him. He's the president for the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith.
Well, if he is not, he should be.
Pardon me?
If he isn't, he should be.
Yeah, the CDF and the New Ways Ministry.
And New Ways Ministry. No, I mean...
I really hope he listens to this.
I am kind of intrigued, actually, by that whole cohort of people, because I've seen this crazy thing. It was reported on Breitbart, to be fair, so I don't know how true it is. But apparently, a lot of clerics and religious groups across the board, not just Catholic, are conducting this operation where they're gonna have underground tunnels for illegals in America. And I'm thinking, why? I mean, like, there's no shortage of opportunities for charity with the homeless, or you know people who are unemployed, or you know people in who are citizens of that country, but they want to focus on the illegals. I mean, I personally don't see why that would be the case, other than maybe some cynical maneuvering. Awesome manner.
I've got a couple of things to mention with regard to that. The first one is, are they going to be responsible for the moral conduct of those people towards the people in the communities which they come to inhabit? So, say a 46-year-old Mexican guy crawls through one of their secret tunnels. He's got some real issues. He goes and rapes and murders a 13-year-old girl walking home from school. Are they going to answer to the parents of that girl? No, I don't think so.
Charity, please. Sorry. Two-post limit.
Yeah, you've got to delete me now. That's it. Yeah, that's a complete joke. These people have no sense of responsibility. This is what I'm talking about with the kind of teenage approach to the common good that these people have, right? No, right. You know, it's all about the fields. You know, all this kind of jazz.
Well, I mean, I think there is an element of truth to, like, just not being a jerk, but that does have its limits. I think you should love our neighbor, obviously, and that falls within the purview.
I've not said anything against that notion at all.
But it gets complicated when you're saying we are going to enable lawbreakers.
Well, whatever happens to render unto Caesar.
Well, I mean, you don't even have to go to render to Caesar. I mean, St. Paul, and I don't mean to turn this into a Catholic podcast necessarily, but I mean, St. Paul said, you know, be subject to the laws. You know, be subject.
I'll stop you there. We all know Scripture isn't Catholic.
Well, I mean, St. Paul was pretty clear. He said, be subject to the laws. Be a law-abiding citizen. Don't provide opportunities, you know, for defiance of the civil order. That is not the way to go about things. And he was saying this in regards to a government far more brutal, I'm sure, than Trump's America. Let's put it that way. I'm pretty sure that Nero is not anybody's model of governance by any means.
I think you'll find that Nero did a lot for transgender rights.
Actually, yeah, I suppose.
Your own history, you'll understand that joke.
The Romans were trailblazers, really, in many respects.
Well, he cut one of he turned one of his slaves into a eunuch and had him dress up as his the wife he'd stomped to death, Poppaea. So you know, he was
like
big
I said,
on the transgender stuff.
He was a trailblazer. This was before Van Helm Reich, okay? We have to give credit where credit is due. That was some progressive legislation right there.
It's Wilhelm Reich, isn't it?
Von Helm. He's German.
One of Sigmund Freud's disciples.
Well, he was a failed disciple. Because...
Wilhelm Reich.
He was a failed disciple, though.
Yeah.
There's an interesting thing about that, actually, because... I don't know whether to admire it, or I wouldn't admire it, but I mean, whether to, like, you know, give credit though. He went up to Freud, and he said, "You're not being political enough." And then he went over to the Communist Party and said, "You're not being psychoanalytic enough." So he was never at home in either camp. And he turned out to be an anti-communist in the end. So he's got a strange tale.
He played both sides.
No, I think he was just crazy.
He was just crazy. Oh, that's good.
Well, I mean, he ended up in a mental asylum. So I'm not even being hyperbolic here.
A little bit like Nietzsche. Went mental. Sorry, that was the syphilis from all those prophecies. What was I going to say? Yeah, so in terms of that comment about people like James Martin, SJ, etc., etc., there was something interesting on the mass sheet of my church about 5-6 weeks ago now. Maybe it was just before Christmas. And it was saying, basically, it said conservatives in Islam, Judaism, and Christianity have far more in common with one another, kind of laterally, as opposed to horizontally, than with the other holders of their own faith.
Do you reckon?
If you understand what I'm saying. So there's like a union of the Orthodox in each faith. Now, this was obviously a criticism of those people, people who happen to keep their own faith, right? Ironically, the corollary of that one is the fact that, obviously, the liberals in those three faiths also have far more in common with one another than with the conservatives in their own faith.
Oh, no, I think there's definitely something to that. I mean, on the Stephen Bannon article, I kind of hinted at that, saying that, you can see that at the MSNBC panel,
yeah,
you have people of all sorts of different, faiths, if you can call them that, and they all agreed. They've all agreed on the same thing. The story was Russia is bad because they're trying to defend traditional values, and we don't want that. Father James Martin goes out and says, "Yeah, I know this is all bad stuff. We don't want to be like Russia. We want to be the field hospital." There is that convergence there, and then they say, "Oh, but no, there is a sinister thing going on with conservatives, that they're all ganging up together against us." But it's like, "Oh, but you're doing that, and you've been doing that for years."
Well, I mean, yeah. One second.
Yeah, do go on.
I forget what we were discussing now.
Liberals and conservatives. Different religions.
I was going to make a point which I forgot now, so...
No, see, I mean, although that does have its limits, though, because, like, for instance... Even now, I wouldn't consider myself a conservative, and I'm not really. I'm not a conservative. I have always been a socialist, and I can say that without any kind of like I don't know. I mean, I don't feel any betrayal there of any kind of like previous socialist things I had, other than the fact that I'm not a Marxist. I mean, and there isn't really, because I think what I've read recently. Again, going back to Michael Jones, and I agree with him that the conflict, or I think like a major conflict, is between labor and capital. I have never been for capital, never. I have always been for labor though, and I don't see how that entails anything other than that, whereas I think a lot of people on the left like to be, and I hate this word, but like to be intersectional, which is to say, because you support this, then you have to support that, which is ridiculous, really. Because like I said, I think E. Michael Jones laid it down pretty well, where he says that the alliance between the radical left and the right, the Rockefellers, millionaires, corporatists, is contraception. And why is that? It's because there's two solutions to poverty, which is either Malthusianism, which is say to the poor, don't breed, or raise their wages. Now, by being a socialist, my instinct is to say, raise their wages. Whereas the left seems perfectly fine with the idea that, yeah, you should just tell the poor not to breed. That is where they unite. So when I say raise the wages, I don't see myself as a conservative in any way. I mean, yeah, I wouldn't call myself a conservative. If anything, the guy who came up with Malthusianism, I mean, he was a bishop of the Church of England.
Thomas Powell.
Yeah, you know, I mean, he wasn't some like crazy guy. Well, I mean, he was, I suppose, a crazy guy, but like, he wasn't like the sort of radical thing. I mean, that was the conservative position to some degree, to say we're not going to share the wealth, we're just going to hoard it, and you just breed less.
Malthus ever argued for eugenics.
Well, I mean, that was eugenics. I mean, at the end of it, eugenics is just a new term for that. I mean, what he said was resources are scarce, and we just have to make sure that it doesn't, you know, we don't end up in a situation where there's too many people. We just need less people. And obviously the implication there, in the context of the time, is that who is doing the breeding? Or is the poor people? I mean, inevitably, that is the context.
Yeah, I mean, in fairness to Malthus, he also didn't support corn laws because he felt that food security was more important than maximizing wealth. And, it, you know, a lot of his stuff was more a diagnosis of an issue than suggesting a cure.
Well, I think the cure is implied in the diagnosis.
Yeah.
I mean, if you see the problem has too many people, what is the solution? Less people. I mean, that goes without saying.
Yeah.
I don't have a lot of time for him. I really don't. I think that it's arguably like one of the worst ideas to come out ever out of the time.
Yeah, mind you, I wouldn't put the sick and twisted interpretation of it all at his door. It is a bad idea, etc., etc.
Oh, but then you can say that about anybody. You can say that about Marx. Marx never said, have the Soviet Union, but that's what happened. He never said that. In fact, that there were plenty of good things that he suggested. Like, you know, let's get rid of child labor.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if we are prepared to hold Marx accountable for things like the Soviet Union...
Insofar as his wasn't entirely diagnostic, if not prophetic work, you know. He said this project must go forward. He said that this thing will succeed. There will be a utopia. You know, he set up a whole system. Malthusianism is nowhere near as developed as that as a philosophical idea.
I suppose that is true. I mean, although there was some good diagnosis there. I mean, what I've heard. You know John Gray, philosopher,
yeah.
John Gray, and I think he put it pretty well when he said that Marx was very, very wrong about socialism, but he was very right about capitalism.
Yeah.
I mean, creative destruction, you know, the rise of monopolies. I mean, he was completely right about that. No one can dispute that. No one can say that he was just, you know, some sort of crackpot. Which he wasn't, you know, I mean, he wasn't a crazy guy in that respect.
Would you say Stephen Bannon is a socialist?
Not at all, no. Well, I mean, he puts it quite well. I mean, he says he's in favor of entrepreneurial capitalism, which I also am, and I think any reasonable person would be. I mean, he's against corporatism, which, I mean, I think it's amazing that Republicans, you know, mainstream so-called Republicans, are against that, when I think one of their own was probably the best proponent of entrepreneurial capitalism, as opposed to, you know, monopolizing crony capitalism. It was the first Roosevelt, Theodore Roosevelt. I mean, he split up J.P. Morgan.
Yeah.
I can't see a Republican doing that now, but, I mean, that was a Republican. I mean, this is the great irony, really. You know, I mean, the Republican Party, in my reading of history, which goes back a long time, actually, because I've been reading about this for a long time. I remember, like, in sixth form, I was quite a big fan of Theodore Roosevelt. I got hold of this book, I don't remember the name of it, it's there somewhere, Going Through the Presidents. And Theodore Roosevelt really struck me as a truly what you would call, even though the term is being perverse now, but a progressive guy, you know, like he was quite progressive the race question in America. He was quite progressive with the unions and the sort of crony capitalism of the time. There was a lot of good stuff there, and I don't see why Republicans nowadays have a big problem with it. When Stephen Bannon comes out and condemns the kind of the monopolies and the kind of seeing people as commodities type of capitalism, I think there's nothing radical about that. To some degree, because that's, I imagine, what Theodore Roosevelt would say, and in fact he'd probably say in much more stringent terms than Bannon has ever said it.
Yeah, I mean, I find myself in a very great deal of agreement with the stuff that Stephen Bannon's written or said, as far as I can tell. I mean, for me personally, obviously, I would never call myself a socialist. I'm in favour of entrepreneurial capitalism. I'm also massively in favour of things like credit unions, building societies, cooperatives, anything essentially that gives some kind of long-term security to people of little means, and also some security that cannot be taken away from them by the state, and that is a barrier to economic crashes, that is a kind of a strengthening beam, if you will, in civil society.
Are you not in favor of unions then? Because unions. I think unions pretty much fit what you just described. I mean, in a traditional sense, anyway.
Yeah, I'm definitely in favor of unions. Yeah, I'm admirers of people like the coal hole masters, etc. What I'm not in favor of is how militant the unions became in this country. So, for instance, which is never told by Labour, they're always, whenever Welbourne is mentioned, you'll always hear them bang on about Tyre and Devon and the Devon boys, the ones who went down the mine, all that kind of stuff. How good Labour was, it came together with the Tories and the rump of the Liberals and, pushed Britain through the war and then came out and won the election. Okay, Labour was also in cahoots with massive unions. There were thousands of strikes across this country throughout World War II. In fact, when pilots were at risk because they weren't packing parachute, all kinds of things. The unions went on strike throughout the war. Okay, so you only have to read the reports. I've read some of things that the union leaders said. They were some of the most callous, hot things I've ever read. They've got guys who are fighting their lives on the front line. They don't give a shit. They just want an extra couple of pence from their work and to line their pockets, likewise, etc.
But doesn't that come down to individuals more than the concept of a union?
No, it does. You're correct. Obviously, the people on the ground made those decisions, but the atmosphere was there. The belief was there. That undergirded this whole. If it had been a few instances, your point would stand. But because it was thousands of instances during World War II, that point doesn't. The unions have become very militant in this country, and they only got worse over time, really. Until you had the issue with 3-day working week, etc., etc., under Teddy Heath, and then under Margaret Thatcher. obviously, there are other points to that. There's far more news than that. Obviously, the industry had been under attack by the government for some time by that point.
Do you know the basic timeline of that though? Because I think the timeline might be revealing. Because you have to remember that for a while there was the kind of agreement between the Soviet Union and Nazi Germany. And we have to remember that there were elements in the unions then that were communists. And obviously they would not be in favor of the war because the Soviet Union was not at war with Germany at the time.
No, you're correct. This formed part of the reports I read. The activity did tend to reduce after the Soviet Union entered the war, the Allied side, if you like. Actually, an interesting anecdote there. I got into an argument with a Russian at university who simply completely refused to recognize the Ribbentrop Pact, Molotov-Ribbentrop. He said that never happened. He said Nazi Germany and the USSR. This was not a stupid guy. He used to recognize that happened.
Is he a Russian?
Yes.
Well, I mean, I think Russians have a kind of like a really distorted sense of history, and I'm only seeing that just on the basis of the fact that there is a hero worship about Stalin.
Well, I think the issue with that is because obviously Stalin saved them from the anarchy, as far as they can tell.
Yeah, I mean that. It is true, but I mean that does cloud your judgment.
Yeah, for certain.
I'm not.
Stalin was the documentation we have. People have said that he watered down his Marxism, his communism. Not actually true. He was just as committed ideologically to the project as anyone else.
Oh, he was. He was.
He wasn't just interested in his own power, which he definitely was, and his own prestige, which he definitely was, and the hero worship of him. He was massively interested in those things. He was also ideologically on board with communism and Marxism.
I think Stalin's only merit is that he did roll back on the sexual revolution of the 1920s. I mean, E. Michael Jones lays it out pretty clear when he says that, you know, during the Stalin era, up until the end of the Lenin rather era, there was a true sexual revolution in Russia, which destroyed families, destroyed the country, and people couldn't have it anymore. All based on ideas of the likes of this lady called Kollontai, who was the first revolutionary, first sexual revolutionary, who said, "Let's not have marriage, let's have no fault divorce, let's make it as easy as possible." Again, on the basis of the fact that she was an aristocrat Russian, her origin, she left her husband. She was like sleeping with just about everybody in the Communist Party, and a sailor, and just random, you know, younger men who liked her good looks.
Like the red film, the pop carousel, wasn't it?
Well, it really was. I mean, it really was. Like, I mean, she was, and there were communists in Russia at the time saying, you can't listen to Lady Kollontai, because she's just out to justify herself and her behavior, and it's destroying Russia. So Stalin clamped down on that, and that's his only merit, in my view, that he could see that there was a disorder, there was, you know, this sort of social upheaval, based on this sort of revolutionary sexual politics, and he got rid of it. He didn't have any time for it.
Well, I think another thing in his favor is he really did take on board and personify the kind of the Malthusian archetype. He solved population issues in the Ukraine, let's remember.
Oh, I mean, I think
can't publish this, mate, because I will get done. I just referenced a lot of
them. No, I do think it is interesting, though, because unlike you, I have actually attended meetings by the Socialist Party, the Aboristov branch. And
hey, I listen to BBC Radio 4. That counts, right?
No, but let me tell you this. If you go to the Socialist Party meetings, they'll be quick to say, oh no, we hate Stalin. But we hate him because he didn't go far enough. He betrayed the revolution. Trotsky was the good guy. And I'm thinking, well, that's kind of like the worst of both worlds, really. As in, like, and that's an idea that has filtered down elsewhere. Because if you remember in Critical Theories, there's this kind of feeling as well. That, you know, Soviet Union wasn't real communism. These are the real communists, you know, the Frankfurt School people. These are the people who really carried it forward. People like Gramsci and, you know...
Foucault?
Oh, no, not Foucault, earlier than Foucault. Horkheimer, you know, Marcuse, all those people. These are the people who really carried it forward. And it's like... Yeah, well, they're carrying forward the worst aspects of it, you know, without the redeeming appreciation for social order that Stalin had, which is, I mean, like I said, his only redeeming factor in my view. But, I mean, that is how the left justifies itself, in a sense. I mean, a lot of the stuff you can see, maybe not Corbyn, but like, you know, his support base spouting all the time is essentially this narrative. The revolution got betrayed. It was never realized. And we are bringing it back now. Whereas it's like, you can't really do that any more than, you can have like, Nazis, you know, neo-Nazis coming out and saying, oh no, we have to remember Hitler did build the autobahns. So he wasn't all that bad after all.
I mean, there are similarities. Go further now, obviously, as you know, Hitler obviously heralded the end of the Weimar Republic, which itself was to a large extent, or you know, facilitated to a large extent, you know, the sexual revolution in Germany in the 1920s too, you know, so...
Oh, I mean, E. Michael Jones, I mean, I think I sent it to you, he compares Hitler and Stalin in that regard. is in they came in as people who safeguarded the social order, because the 1920s was so chaotic and so destructive of the moral fiber of those two countries that something had to be done. I mean, although with Hitler, I mean, like I said, and this goes to the neo-Nazis as well, or the alt-right, as they are called nowadays, is that, like, I mean, you have to, there's no escape from the fact that a great deal of the Nazi Party were degenerates. I mean,
They're pretty good blokes, actually.
Oh. No, I mean, I'm serious. I mean, you know the Ernst Röhm story, you know, how he was gay and stuff like that. I mean, the brown shirts. I mean, there is the homoeroticism to Nazism, to the Nazis, which you can't really escape. It's there.
Chesterton said, "By worshipping man, the Greeks became unmanly. By worshipping nature, become unnatural." You know, it's exactly the thing that happened to the Nazis. They had this kind of neoclassical appreciation, especially of the masculine form. Women were essentially just like, they did appreciate the feminine form as well.
No, they were breeders. You know, they were breeders. They were literally put in, like, breeding houses. That's the diminished view. That's the diminished view of women that they had.
Well, that's not... there's a slight difference there, because they also, as any healthy civilization does, I mean, they weren't healthy in many other ways, but this, they were. They idolized women as mothers. So you can see that by looking at their arm. But in terms of the actual physical form of a female...
To some degree,
because
I mean, having studied this quite comprehensively, there was a distinction between the Nazi policy for the whole world to see, which was the, you know, the I forget the German phrase, but it was, you know, church, women, and kitchen, or whatever it was. That was it. Yeah, that was for the world to see, and that was the public policy. But, I mean, in a more secluded area where they could get away with stuff, I mean, they had breeding houses, essentially. They, where, you know, the SS soldiers would go there, and they would have these women, this harem, essentially, where they would breed. I mean, that was the view that they actually believed in. But obviously, you can't sell that to the mainstream German society at the time. But that was the view.
Yeah, I know. They were designed to... breed a master race of soldiers for the Germans, right? Yeah, I mean,
it's a diminished view.
Just getting back to it. So yeah, their view of women was obviously, you know, just as breed as well, and even there was an idolization of women as mothers to an extent, but as you say, it was a limited extent. But yeah, just in terms of the physical form, there was no real idolization of the female, but there was of the male. You know, in the very Greek sense of that. You know, the statues and all that kind of stuff. The Olympic stadiums, the statues they had there, the artwork in the Olympic stadiums. Yeah, it was basically just...
Oh, it's homoerotic.
Yeah, I mean, it is. Yeah.
They can't escape
it. I'm sure a lot of it wasn't meant to, but the underlying tenor and tone of it was, as you say, homoerotic.
I mean, obviously, like, it's... and again, as most of these things usually turn out, it goes back to the main guy. I mean, if you look at Hitler's kind of sexual history, again, you end up with something very, very disturbed. I mean, there is the incest with his niece, where she committed suicide.
What?
And then, obviously, I mean, he had a kind of normal relation with Eva Braun. But that was this incestuous thing to Hitler as well. So, I mean, we're talking about somebody who is completely unregulated, morally.
He also had that. He's also got a surviving child, hasn't he?
No, he didn't have to.
With that French, Jean-Marie Lorette.
Well, he had a child.
Well, let me just,
So,
I mean, what we were talking about was initially was trade unions. My opinion on trade unions. Yeah, so I think I'm fully supportive of trade unions. I'm not supportive of unrestrained capital versus the rights of labour. You know, I'm fully on board with, obviously as a Catholic, I'm fully on board with what's said in Rerum Novarum, which is that the economy should be at the service of man, not man at the service of the economy. Man should not be, to me, that's just, that goes without general, I'm not overly fond of putting economic principles before any other principles, which I think has become very popular in the last, especially since Margaret Thatcher's time, which is not necessarily what she intended at all, but she released the beast, as it were. She and Milton Friedman.
It's the Bill Clinton view.
It's the what, sorry?
It's the Bill Clinton view.
It's the economy, stupid. Yeah, I know. But if obviously greed has always been forefront, in man since the fall, really. So I guess in my personal philosophy, I wouldn't call myself a socialist. I'm just more like a kind of patriarchal high Tory, basically, in the English sense. I'm more interested in things like, the land economy, agriculture. I'm more interested in that. I'm more interested in, having a more balanced economy. So I would want to move away from a service-based economy as much as possible. I mean, we are very good at services in this country.
I don't think it's service so much. It's financial. It's financial. Because it's like...
Well, this is true, but if you let me finish slightly, in terms of the service economy, for instance, I was watching a report yesterday that came from York by the BBC. Here's this for impartiality. Basically, it was railing against immigration cuts. It just had segment after segment about the fact that all these businesses needed low-wage immigrants. Now, they didn't say that. They just said immigrants. We need immigrants to survive. Now, what they meant was we need low-wage immigrants who aren't going to ask for any more. Because they've got no unions to represent them, obviously, etc., etc. Now, that is simply predicated upon a service-based economy, okay? Because you have so many people who own these businesses, etc., etc., running these service-based industries, which require a large amount of staff, which require people to come in from outside. So, having a service-based economy has all kinds of issues itself. So it's not just the financial services, I'm talking services in general.
Well, I mean, with the request for immigration that a lot of people make, again, I think there is also a kind of inescapable demographic element of it. I mean, like I said, you need strong young people to work, to do heavy work. There isn't the supply. And there may be different reasons for that. I mean, in some cases, you might say people are not willing to do the work, which I know is the case in some cases. And also, so there's not that many people to do that. As in, the population of the UK is very large, but I mean... Well, over here, it's not quite like Japan level, but it is the case that there is a great number of old people who are not going to be able to do their jobs.
No.
Or people in between. You have to be young, you have to be strong, to do stuff like that. You're not going to get a 30-year-old, you're not going to get a 40-year-old doing that stuff. But again, I mean, this is a question of, this is the contraception question.
Yeah.
As in, if it hadn't been the case... that people had contracepted themselves out of existence, this wouldn't be necessary.
Yeah. Well, no, exactly.
No one wants to talk about it. I saw the greatest juxtaposition. There was this article, not article rather, the like different magazine covers. I think it was shared by Milo actually.
And yeah, it was National Geographic.
Yeah,
one that was supporting the childless life, and one was saying. New Europeans.
Yeah, you saw that one.
Full of glee, yeah. It actually made me very angry.
Well, but that is the reality. There is a reality. There are people who are wealthy and healthy, and they don't want to have any children. And there's plenty of people who are more than happy to occupy the labor force. That's a demographic reality. I mean, you can't escape that. I mean, if you are a company and you need people doing that work, you can't blame them, for saying, I guess we just need immigration. Because nobody else is having children.
Well, no.
It is a great cost, to have children. I remember, in my sort of informal study of the welfare state, there is a very strong anti-family kind of thing going on there. And I'll give you one example. I'm not sure if this is even an example that is scientific enough that it could use it. But basically, for instance, because the council would provide more housing benefit. Now, Well, it works out in a manner that I couldn't put it better than a fellow co-worker in Weatherspoon's did, because he was in the same situation. His mom was forcing him out of the family home. Why? Because she couldn't get housing benefit to the same extent that she would if he moved out. That's a policy that splits families up. That's not a pro-family policy. The very fact that they have policies like these in place will necessarily result in a situation where families are splitting up just because the welfare state kind of like requires that as an ideal. That you're kicking people out all the time. And not only that, they will happily provide the person who has been kicked out with more benefits rather than keep it as a family unit, where it would be cheaper, in fact, to say have a reasonable housing benefit for a family unit than it would be to say let's kick out somebody else who has to occupy it in another house, which again costs. I mean, it takes up space and it takes up money as well.
Yeah.
But that is the policy of the government, and it's an anti-family policy. I was going to write a whole article about this, just because like I thought how wrong this was. That, you know, the government would rather split families and then give more benefits to each, like, people, than keep them together and just have a reasonable one for that particular unit.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's also the case, obviously, in a less direct way, that the government supports single-parent families because it gives a large amount of benefits to single mothers. With children, one or more children.
I mean, that's also, again, an anti-family policy, if you think about it.
That's exactly what I'm saying, yeah. Yeah, obviously, there's also the fact that those people are disproportionately Labour Party supporters. and it was, I believe it was Tony Blair that brought in that kind of legislation for single-parent families. Now, I've had an argument with someone who is a single mother on this issue. And it was very revealing. Very revealing of the attitude.
Go on.
It's not all that interesting. I'm just saying I've actually talked to someone who is in that situation about it, and they recognise that they are being, their vote is being pawned, but they're not all that interested. They don't care. They just want the money. I don't think I actually discussed the idea that it was encouraging single mothers as such, as a proper positive action. But it certainly is. I mean, I more discussed it along the lines of the fact that it incentivized that kind of action.
Well, that's the thing that people don't realize. That's going to look at something, but you can still hear me. I mean, that's the thing that people don't realize, which is like any law is not purely a prescriptive thing. It determines what goes on. You know, there's nothing neutral about it. I mean, the moment you pass a law, and this was the issue definitely with gay marriage, where people take this kind of libertarian view that is like, if it doesn't affect anybody else directly, that means it doesn't affect anybody in any way over any period of time. Whereas it does, you know, like laws like that do have an impact. Any law that is passed is not only descriptive of a situation, as in like people may say, like, you know, if you pass a law, oh no, you're only now addressing an issue that's already there anyway, right?
Yeah.
But it's not only that. I mean, a law is not just descriptive of something that's already there. A law is also prescriptive.
Yeah, for sure.
If something is lawful, it is prescriptive for the society. It says, this is okay now.
This is normal.
This is all right. You can do this. It's in the law. It's lawful.
Well, I mean, it's just exactly the same as the ramifications of, you know, Masters and Johnson's studies into sex, sexual behavior. So their method of analysis was... you know, I think it's best kind of summarized in the poem Creed. I think I've said that to you before now. And it says, what's selected is average. What's average is normal. What's normal is good.
Yeah, well, yeah. You can't really argue with that. I mean, any law that is passed that takes an unusual situation has been the basis of a particular piece of legislation is normative. It becomes normative by the fact that it is law. Now, yeah. I'm not saying that single mothers, like in an ideal scenario, single mothers should get a kick in the face, you know, and told to, I don't know, have been more discerning in their choices of sexual partners. No, I'm not saying that because that would be callous. I think people should be provided regardless, or they should be provided something. But not in a manner that outright says, okay, this is all right, you know, like, this is ideal. Because it's not ideal. Anybody who knows anything knows that's not ideal. Even in cases like divorce, no-fault divorce, that's not an ideal situation. As he knows, there are some cases where divorce is the best thing. And I'm sure that is the case, you know, I'm not like an ideologue on the question of divorce, you know, of all things. But it is also the case that, like, there are consequences. There are consequences to liberalizing that.
How do you mean you're not an ideologue?
I mean, in the sense that, I mean, ideally people would stick together, but obviously there are situations where that is just not possible. For the welfare of the people in that relationship.
Yeah.
You have to like be aware of that. But you can't take that to be normative. You can't take that to be...
So you think that the church's doctrine on divorce should be updated?
Sorry?
You think the church's doctrine and teaching on divorce should be updated?
Well, as you know, obviously not. I don't think that's the case, no.
Why?
Why? No, I mean... because it legitimizes divorce at the end of the day. It legitimizes it.
People shouldn't divorce, they should separate instead.
Indeed. Which is the church position, in fact.
Yeah.
People can separate for valid reasons, but they can't divorce. I mean, like, leaving civil law aside for a second. I mean, the church is prudent in that. You can separate when you have a situation where the welfare of the people concerned is threatened by their union, but you can't divorce. It's not open. That's just not an open venue.
What about free love?
There's no such thing as free love. To quote Chesterton, in fact, love by its very nature is binding. So free love is a contradiction in terms.
I believe he also went on to say that the church simply paid man the courtesy of taking him at his word.
Oh, yeah.
After all songs of romance and eternal love.
Oh, yeah, exactly. I mean, that's an important step, you know. I mean, I know for sure that people can make mistakes, you know, people can make mistakes. I mean, certainly, you know, if it happened to me, you know, if tomorrow I bumped into some seemingly amazing girl and said, let's marry, I'd be like, okay. Let's do it. And then she turned out to be a crazy sort of person. That would be really, really unfortunate. And
by crazy sort of person, do you mean a woman?
Well, I suppose that is the case, isn't it? I mean, a level of crazy that I wouldn't be comfortable with.
Okay. Some crazy is actually good, to be fair. Adds a little bit of spice.
But like, you'll be unfortunate, you know, to separate from that. But at the same time, you know, I'm given way too much dignity by being taken at my word, surely. There is no denigration there. Quite the contrary.
Yeah.
And I think people don't understand that nowadays. I mean, at least insofar as the Guardian columns are concerned, because there's always that kind of implication. When you read all of the sort of agony aunts kind of stories on the Guardian. And so I was like, this wasn't what I subscribed to. I wasn't expecting this, or this is some terrible stuff. Usually it's quite trivial. No, usually it's an issue that can be resolved by a conversation. But it's there. You know, people say, okay, this isn't what I subscribed to. I want out of it. Which I think is kind of like consumerist contract, which is, you know, I don't like the product. I bought it. I don't like the product. I want it back. You know, like I want my money back.
Yeah.
And that's not the attitude you can ever take, is it?
Yeah. Well, I mean, this is Pope Francis has said quite a number of times, which is the idea that people are now unwilling to make almost irrevocable choices. They're unwilling to dedicate themselves to something holy. They always have, what's, I can't remember the phrase he said. He didn't say they have like an a la carte approach to things. That's essentially what he was saying. I don't recall if he actually used those exact words, but they kind of have this approach of, well, they keep something back, you know, just in case.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's the thing, the kind of like, what the diminishment of the sacramental view of the world has ultimately caused. You know, because, I mean, if you think about it, somebody who takes up the priesthood, it's not doing it part-time. He's not doing it like a part-time job where we go, oh, okay, I'm doing this till something else turns up. No, I mean, like, you're in it for life, you know?
Yeah.
And it's the same thing with marriage, surely.
Wow, that's something quite interesting, yeah.
Time.